So let's see what are the artificial teeth, which has been already covered by Dr. Ajay, but I'll just go a couple of slides which are very important as far as teeth arrangement is concerned. Based on occlusal form, we have anatomic, non-anatomic and semi-anatomic teeth, and based on materials used, we have porcelain, acrylic, hard acrylic and composite. So anatomic, they exactly replicate the newly formed teeth, and they are at 33 degrees inclination, very highly aesthetic. Proper contours for crushing, greater chipping efficiency, but they come with a disadvantage that it's a little difficult to make the balancing, which is going to be important factor. They also are responsible for interferences during settling in. The settling in means once you deliver the denture takes some time to adjust to the soft tissues. During this time, the denture changes its position, leading to a lot of interferences if we are using anatomic teeth. So more lateral stresses are generated when we use anatomic teeth, and settling in also causes a lot of rigid resorption because a lot of force being generated on the mandibular ridge. Semi-anatomic teeth are the teeth which are having 20 degrees angulation, and they range from 10 to 20 degrees angulation is the most commonly used teeth set nowadays during preclinical as well as in the clinical. So they are easy to arrange in balanced occlusion. It reduces a lot of lateral stresses, but the biggest disadvantage being they are less aesthetic compared to anatomic teeth because the cuspal tips are rounded and also have less chipping efficiency. So if you see the photograph, the anatomic teeth have a very, very sharp cusp, exactly replicating the natural erupted teeth. And semi-anatomic teeth, there is a shallow surface on the occlusion, and the cuspal height is also reduced. So they have a lot of freedom in lateral movement as well as in the anteroposterior movement. But non-anatomic teeth are just flat. They are very poor in chipping efficiency, because they just do chop-chop, there is no sharing of the foot. Non-anatomic teeth, also called as zero-degree flat or monocline teeth, this non-anatomic teeth was proposed based on neutrocentric occlusion theory. So this is a very superior formula in the West during probably few years back. So they are used in patients with who present with very highly resorbed ridges, patient present with poor neuromuscular control. Advantages being horizontal forces are not generated because there are no cusps, and fewer forces are transferred to the residual alveolar ridge. Disadvantages being difficult to attain balancing, poor aesthetics and poor chewing efficiency. So when we do the balancing, we do something called as balancing ramp, which will help in getting the tripodal contact. So here a small disclaimer, we don't promote any brand, but Acrylrock being widely used among most of the dental colleges. So I just took some material from the Acrylrock for better understanding, because most of us are using these teeth during the examination, both in PG and UG level. So when we do the selection of teeth, there are two types of selection, that is anterior teeth selection and posterior teeth selection. Anterior teeth selection based on the shape of the face. Here in the photograph it is shown, square face will have a square type of teeth, tapered face will have a tapered type of teeth, and ovoid face will have an ovoid type of teeth. It also depends on the arch form. The ovoid arch will have ovoid teeth, tapered arch will have a tapered teeth, and squarish arch will have a square teeth. So when we see a teeth set, this is how you see during the teeth arrangement. So what you see is two numbers. You see one on the left side of the teeth set, other on the right side of the teeth set. The left side of the teeth set denotes the shade of the teeth set, and right side teeth set, here it is written D44. I hope you can see this very faintly. It is visible. D44 denotes the nomenclature. We'll go in detail about it. So when we consider molars, we have anatomic teeth and we have geometric teeth. Anatomic teeth are having the cuspal inclination of 25 to 33 degrees, and semi-anatomic or geometric teeth have 20 degrees cuspal inclination. So every student has to go to the catalog of that particular teeth set which they are using. So in every in every nomenclature, supposing if I consider S15, here you can see bottom S15. So under S15, there is 1, 2, 3, 4. The 1 is the combined width of 6 anteriors, that is distal of canine to distal of canine. 2 is the length of the tooth from the cervical line to the incisal edge. And 3 is from the edge of the cervical zone to the incisal edge. And 4 is width of the tooth. So this is what we have to understand whenever we do selection of the teeth. So supposing if I am taking the example of S15, here S15 stands for nomenclature, and 1 stands for combined width of 6 anteriors, 2 for height from cervical line to incisal edge, 3 from the cervical edge to incisal edge, 4 and width of the teeth. And there is something called as articulation table on the right side. So company says that when we are using S15 as upper anterior, use 138 as lower anterior and D37 or D43 for the posterior. D37 is anatomic and D43 is the semi-anatomic teeth, that is geometric teeth in this context. The same manner, even the selection of posterior teeth is done 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 is upper 4 posterior, 2 stands for lower 4 posterior visual distal width, 3 stands for buccolingual width, and 4 stands for the buccolingual, 3 stands for buccolingual width of the upper molar, and 4 stands for the buccolingual width of the lower molar. So let us see a little bit of occlusion and some salient features before we actually start arranging the teeth. The relationship between the occlusion surface of the maxillary and mandibular teeth when they are in contact at occlusion and when they are in dynamic movement during centric and eccentric motion is called as articulation. So there are 5 objectives which we have to understand of complete denture occlusion. Complete denture occlusion should provide maximum intercuspation so that there is maximum chewing efficiency, which minimizes the stresses and aid in stability and retention of the dentures. And it also should not put lot of load on the tissues, which will end up in resorption. In the natural dentition, this is a class 1 classic dentition where there is maximum intercuspation, that is in centric occlusion. But when the patient takes the jaw to right or left, that is called as lateral excursion, either you have a canine guided occlusion or you have a groove function. Canine guided means when you take the jaw to left, only tip of the canine is touching and rest all are out of contact, that is excluded. And groove function is entire portion of that, if I'm moving my jaw to right side, that is my right would be working side, and all the teeth touches, that is groove function. At your level, I think this much is enough. But when the patient takes the jaw to edge, there is a big space which gets created in the posterior aspect, which is called Christensen's phenomena. You can see here a wedge-shaped defect. So this Christensen's phenomena should not be there in the complete dentures, because natural teeth are embedded in the bone. Natural teeth are very, very strong. They have proprioception, they have nerve supply. They generate a tremendous amount of force. But in the complete denture, the entire one upper denture will act as one unit. Meaning, when the patient takes the completely dentureless patient who is wearing the denture, takes it to edge, there is, if you create a space in the posterior, just like natural teeth, there will be tipping of the posterior. So we need to do something called as bilateral balanced occlusion. So all the principles what we follow while arranging the teeth will land in a proper balanced occlusion. Of course, we are doing on mean value articulator, which is little difficult to analyze what we have done. But as far as second year are concerned, we do teeth arrangement on my mean value articulator only. So bilateral balanced occlusion is a bilateral simultaneous anterior and posterior occlusal contact in centric and eccentric position, both on right and left side, so that the denture stability is maintained. The objective is to compensate for the Christensen's phenomena, which we have discussed. There are 5 factors which influence the balanced occlusion: condylar guidance, incisal guidance, plane of occlusion, cuspal inclinations, and compensating curves. We'll just look quickly one by one. Condylar guidance is the guidance by which the condyle travels along the wall of the glenoid fossa or the contour of the glenoid fossa. This angle what it creates is called a condylar guidance. This condylar guidance is not under the control of dentist, which is fixed in the patient's mouth, or in the jaw. So incisal guidance is nothing but the influence of contacting surface of maxillary and mandibular teeth during mandibular movements. So here very important parameter is the overjet and overbite. The overjet is the horizontal overlap between the lower central incisor and the upper central incisor, whereas vertical overlap is the distance between the tip of the lower central incisor and the tip of the upper central incisor. So here we have all been taught that the overjet and overbite should be 2 millimeters, 3 millimeters, whatever. But I'll give you a practical proposal for how much it should be. So the anterior guidance is under the control of dentist. So we have lot of we can do lot of changes to get the occlusion into balanced occlusion. Third is plane of occlusion. Plane of occlusion is nothing but average plane established by incisal and occlusal surface. So in the patient's mouth, this plane of occlusion is made parallel to Camper's plane, that is allotrachal plane, as well as the interpupillary line. Plane of occlusion cannot be altered much. It may be altered probably for 5 to 10 degrees. Why? I'll explain. If you take the plane of occlusion too high, then tongue will have to really work hard to put food on the occlusal table. And if you take the plane of occlusion too low, there will be less space for the arrangement of lower teeth, and the tongue keeps on getting bitten while eating. So this is the reason we have to establish a proper plane of occlusion. Cuspal inclines, we have already spoken. Anatomic teeth, the 33 degrees, semi-anatomic maybe 20, non-anatomic which is flat. So we can alter a lot of cuspal inclinations to get the things into balancing. We use all the for practical purposes the semi-anatomic teeth. So the most important aspect of balanced occlusion factors is compensating curves. Students, please pay attention, because most of you will be asked about compensating curves during the viva voce. So it's a curve, which are artificial curves introduced in the complete denture to achieve balanced occlusion. This is this compensates for the Christensen's phenomena, that is a space which exists in the posterior region when the patient takes the jaw front or lateral excursion. Two types of curves, anteroposterior as well as mediolateral curve. Anteroposterior curve is nothing but a curve of Spee given by von Graf Spee in 1980. So this is the curve starting from the tip of the canine, passes through the cuspal tips of all the posteriors, goes to the anterior portion of the condyle. This is called as curve of Spee. And when we arrange the teeth, the teeth have to follow the curve of Spee so that we can establish a balanced occlusion. So next is curve of Wilson. This is a mediolateral curve. The curve of Wilson is seen in the molars, where upper molars are buccally tilted and distally tilted. Upper molars are, try to understand this, when the upper molars are buccally tilted, the lower molars also are tilted according to the upper, that is lingual tilt. So we get a curve which is concave in the upper and then convex in the lower. This is called as curve of Wilson. The practical application of curve of Wilson we are going to discuss in later slides. So when we combine the curve of Spee and the curve of Wilson, we get curve of Monson, which is based on spherical theory of occlusion, where when we join the curve of Spee and curve of Wilson with the center in the glabella with 4 inches of diameter, we get a sphere, meaning practically all the cusp tips and all the incisal edges forms the surface of the sphere. So this is a curve of Monson. So let's see features of class 1 relationship, class 1 molar relationship, where we understand that mesobuccal cusp of the upper falls in the mesobuccal groove of the lower first molar, and the canine relation, the mesial slope of the upper canine opposes the distal slope of the lower canine. So this is what is our final goal to achieve. Horizontal overlap and vertical overlap, which we have already discussed, the horizontal overlap should be 1 to 2 millimeters, and vertical overlap, as we already say, it should be 2 millimeters, but the desirable vertical overlap is 0.5 to 1 millimeter. This 1 millimeter overlap is enough for getting good aesthetics and phonetics, where the upper teeth, where the lower teeth have to travel very little to get into edge to edge, where the Christensen's phenomena, that is the space, is less, so that we can achieve a better balance.